Okay, so I will just give a brief summary of a few things that I and my colleagues and students have done for doing fast packet I/O and virtual switching and interaction with virtual machines. The problem that we were addressing at the beginning was that the packet I/O performance in the OS, I come from a BSD community, but I mean that applies also to Linux, was not up to the speed of a 10 gig link. So we tried to fix this problem first, and then we tried to see how we could use the same ideas for virtual switching and also for interconnection of virtual machines. The goal, the reason why we were focusing on packet I/O is that there are many applications such as software routers, middle boxes, applications that do transactions, etc., which really need to exchange packets at a very high rate. Bulk I/O, bulk TCP connections are a different story, but there are still problems there which we are addressing now and will not be part of this presentation. Our main results are three, basically. 2 years ago, we came up with a framework which is OS bypass for the network stack called netmap. Think in principle something similar to PF packet or BPF, etc., but 10 to 40 times faster. So we can saturate 10 gig interface with the shortest possible packet with just one core at less than 1 gigahertz, and the same kind of speed is available on the receive path. Then we try to use the same ideas to build a virtual switch. This is a completely done in software and provides a generic interconnector between processes or virtual machines. And for one port, the throughput is about 20 million packets per second or 70 gigabits per second. If we have multiple ports sending to the same destination, it scales pretty well. So we measured recently over 50 million packets per second in sending to that destination. And then we tried to see how fast virtual machines could run on top of either interfaces using the NetMap API or the virtual switch. We found out that we were using QEMU and KVM as our test platform. We found out that there were several bottlenecks in the I/O path. Even if we were using virtual I/O, there were still issues in achieving high packet rates. But anyways, with the number of small changes, we managed to accelerate the I/O paths and implement a private virtualized version of the 1000 driver. And basically, we achieve guest-to-guest rates which are similar to those of bare metal, over a million packets per second between two applications sending UDP packets. And if in the guest we are using NetMap, we can exchange about 5 million packets per second between these virtual machines. So the throughput is pretty good. There is some latency which is involved in this communication, but that's mostly part of a limitation of the QEMU KVM architecture. It's not something that our switches, etc., worsen. So we did some recent enhancement to these components. Basically, the initial version of the switch wasn't able to connect directly to the physical interfaces, but now we have supplied this capability. The initial version of the switch only implemented the learning Ethernet bridge, but now we have made the function that makes forwarding decision configurable. So, for instance, we can plug in the valet forwarding plane with the openvswitch logic, and so we can have a very fast openvswitch. Or we can use the switch to do packet the multiplexing using TCP IP ports and addresses as the key to forward packets to one destination or another one. And also we are extending the network framework so that we can support scatter-gather I/O. So bulk traffic through the switch or to the physical interface will be handled very, very efficient. And that's a good thing because it integrates very well with DSO and all sorts of accelerations that are used when handling bulk traffic. Okay. This code is already part of the FreeBSD distribution, and I have a version for Linux that can be loaded as an add-on module without any modification to the kernel. What I would like to see is if there is any way to try and integrate this code into the Linux tree, and I'm open to discussion. I know that a lot of people are using NetMap under Linux in products or in development or in research. So I think there is some interest. And also, having NetMap in the Linux tree or in the network pack doesn't impact performance of the standard network stack when you're using it in a regular way. So the key ideas of NetMap were to design something that would be fast but didn't rely on special hardware features and that could amortize certain costs such as system calls, allocations, copies, etc., and reduce runtime decisions. For instance, in the network stack, on every packet you have to make a lot of decisions whether the packet is fragmented or not, whether you're using acceleration at which points of the stack, etc., etc. We try to make the processing of the packet, at least in the kernel, as simple as possible and to amortize such decisions, to remove unnecessary work, for instance, copies, etc., etc., so that we could achieve decent performance. Now, all of this is not new. I mean, these ideas have been out forever. In principle, in practice, they are not always implemented altogether. The thing that makes NetMap, I think, more interesting than some other alternatives is that we try to make our code very unintrusive with respect to the rest of the kernel. We try to minimize the number of changes to the device driver. We don't want to write 5 to 10,000 lines of code for every new piece of hardware that we have to support. And we also wanted to make the system relatively safe in that, for instance, if you compare it to other alternatives, many of them run the device drivers in user space using IOMMU or some other strategy to export, to make the hardware accessible to a user space process and control the registers, etc. We try to avoid all of this. Also, one thing that we provide is support for blocking I/O. So we have a file descriptor through which we can synchronize with the kernel and be notified and woken up when there are incoming packets available or there is room for transmitting new data. Other approaches instead often spin on state variables or something to check when there is a possibility to transmit or receive data. The basic operation in NetMap is shown by the picture on the right. Basically, when the interface can operate in standard mode, the regular Linux or BSD stack, or in NetMap mode. When you switch to NetMap mode, and this is a runtime decision, so you can revert it very easily, the stack and the NIC are disconnected, and all the packets from or to the NIC are made available to a user space application through a software ring with associated buffers, which is memory mapped. And the same goes for packets from the host stack. The disconnect is done without breaking any existing connection. The operating system or the network stack is not aware that we are disconnecting the data. So if there is any TCP session going through the NIC, those packets, the operating system will still try to send those packets, except that they will end up in this set of buffers, from which we can grab them from user space and manipulate them, push them down. And the same goes for the other direction. So we receive packets directed to the host. We can decide what to do with them, for instance, use a firewall, do encapsulation, etc., and then eventually pass the interesting ones to the host stack. In the original version of NetMap, this processing, this reconnection, if you want, from the NIC and to the host stack was done entirely in user space. But the changes that we have done recently support this reconnection also within the kernel. Now, what is the advantage? The advantage is that we can process data through the red path much more efficiently than what we can do in the standard Linux stack. The information between the NIC and the user space process is in a memory map region which contains packet buffers and a software ring, which is basically packet descriptors. These software rings mimics the ring that the hardware supplies, except that the software ring is device independent. We have 8 bytes per entry, no matter what the underlying hardware format is. And the communication between the user space and the kernel is managed by through system calls. So whatever the user space process writes into this shared memory region is validated by the kernel before being used to program the hardware itself. The user API is very, very simple and mimics what you do with, for instance, BPF or PF packet. So you get a file descriptor, in our case, opening a special device name, issue an IOCTL to put one interface in netmap mode. So you do this this connection that I was mentioning before, and then memory map the region that contains all the data structure. The IOCTL also tells you, gives you a pointer to this blue region with the pointers, which has references to all the software links, and from there you can reach all the buffers, etc. Then we have two ways to do I/O. One is non-blocking. We have IOCTL to send and receive packets, and one is blocking. We can use poll and select. The key thing is that with every system call, we can send or receive a large batch of packets. We are not limited to one packet per system call, and that makes the system very efficient. Together with the fact that buffers are exported in user space and are used directly from the NIC, so there are no copies involved in most cases. Also, an interesting feature here is that the interrupt service routine or the NAPI thread, etc., do no work in the netmap case. Their only role is to wake up the user space process, and it is there where all the processing occurs. So you don't even have to worry too much about CPU affinity or spending or scheduling those threads in order to avoid live lock and similar problems. I mentioned that the host stack is not aware that there is a disconnection, so packets from the host stack are still available. Coming from the host stack are made available to a software ring similar to this, and you can access those packets and move them to another ring in, using the file descriptor and the same API I described before. Performance is excellent. So in this graph, you see with variable clock speed how fast you can transmit. With the socket-based API in FreeBSD, for instance, you're limited to about a million packets per second. I'm sure Linux is a bit faster than that. The in-kernel packet gen peaks at about 4 million packets per CPU, at least the last time I measured. Netmap bypasses everything. Yeah. Yes. And when you use Netmap, you basically do line rate with less than a gigahertz. And then if you have multiple transmitter rings, as most modern hardware does, you can assign a thread to each ring and use the standard pre-thread set affinity to bind the ring to a CPU, etc. So it scales reasonably well. We ported several applications on top of Netmap with good performance gains. The nice thing is that we have a very small pickup library that runs on top of Netmap, so you don't even need to recompile an application in order to get the performance enhancement. Of course, if the application is a good one. Yeah. So there is a user space version. There is a user space version of openvswitch, which we tested 2 years ago, and it uses it uses PF packet to the I/O with the kernel. This is not in kernel of yes. Yep. Mm-hmm. That's part, yes, we're doing a copy. It's part of the switching, the software switch. I'm going to show something on that in a moment. So, and here it is. So, after building this fast API to send packets to the NIC, we wonder if there was a good way to use the same ideas to interconnect virtual machines, for instance. And so it was a very simple extension of the Netmap kernel module to build the virtual switch. Basically, all these ports that you see use the same API. So you open that Netmap, issue an IOCTL. Instead of specifying an interface name, you specify this special name, vale x colon y, where x is the switch name and y is the port name on the switch. Those are completely arbitrary strings. And then you can create multiple instances of a switch and multiple ports on each switch. And each of them acts as a learning bridge. Each differently from NetMap. In NetMap, the memory region is the same for all interfaces in the system. That's because our target application was a software router or software switch, and that having a single memory region enables zero copy forwarding between ports. With the software switch, the issue is different. You have different virtual machines. You don't want them to interfere with each other. So we decided to have a copy when we move a packet from one source to a to one destination. That's moderately expensive, but it seems to be the cheapest way to ensure that the virtual machine are isolated. The switch, there is no time now to discuss this, but implies employs several techniques to improve performance and exploit batching. So, for instance, instead of sending one packet at a time, we first compute all the packets that go to a destination and then send the entire batch to that destination in one shot. So we reduce the locking cost, etc. And so this is the kind of performance that we achieve, and way more than the 10 gig interface. As a comparison, for instance, you can see the nanoseconds per packet that we spend on our switch, the curve here, and this is the nanoseconds per packet that the openvswitch, the internal version of openvswitch consumes. And this curve is what you get if you use hardware support to do switching. For instance, some new interfaces, well, not really new, with multiple queue can forward from one queue to another one, but the bottleneck there is the PCI Express bandwidth. The next, yes. Yes. It is a kernel model. Basically, the NetMap module also includes the Valet functionality. So the next step was These are with the batch. Not really, in the sense that we don't explicitly wait for the batch to be complete. We just send whatever number of packets are available. And the batching has a very nice effect because it's self-regulating. If you're fast, you take one packet at a time. If you become slow, the batch becomes longer, you become more efficient. Yeah. These are, I mean, they don't make latency worse, but. No. This is basically improving the throughput, yes. I mean, there are some simplification, cutting corners, if you like, in the code, but there you're saving perhaps 15 nanoseconds per packet or something like that. And so this is not relevant for latency. Where you waste time is in scheduling and cache misses, etc., and handoffs between the threads. Final thing, and I try to be short. So virtual machines are typically slow, and we notice that, for instance, if we take KVM and Linux or BSD guest on top of QEMU KVM, with an emulated interface, we can do only 20 to 50 or 60,000 packets per second. With VIRT.io, we probably go up to a couple of 100,000 packets per second, 300 maybe. But those are not very high numbers. The bare metal is much faster than that. So we were wondering if there was a better way to get similar performance on bare metal and on virtual machines. And we actually achieved pretty good results, so the numbers are here, and there is a paper that I'm going to present in next month in San Jose at ANCS, which gives you all the details. The interesting part is that we achieved those performance by a number of small changes in the guest device driver in the host front end, in the host back end, and in the virtual switch. All combined, those changes are really small. I mean, of course, I'm mentioning 600 lines in total. Of course, once you engineer the thing and you talk to the QMO people so that make sure that a feature is only available in, is backward compatible, et cetera, the code size explodes, but the size is still small and manageable. And the tricks were, on the virtual machine side, basically trying to minimize the VM exits, which are terribly expensive, and in the bare metal, you don't care very much if you are accessing I/O registers a lot because they're relatively cheap. In the virtual machine, of course, those operations are 100 times more expensive. So you really need to be concerned about that and reduce them. We implemented a paravirtualized mode for the E1000, which is very little code and gets the same performance as Virt.io. And then we, after improving the performance there, we found out that the data path in QEMU was extremely slow. There were a lot of places where we were, or they, or we were doing extra copies, recomputing the translation between guest physical memory and host virtual memory. And those mappings are basically static and unless the machine migrates, but you have an explicit notification there. So you can cache a lot of this information and improve performance a lot. So by implementing fixes here and there, we managed to go, this is just a table that summarizes what we did. So the starting point was these two black numbers. So standard QEMU and KVM, standard Linux kernel, one CPU, one virtual CPU gets you 24,000 packets per second. By implementing interrupt moderation in the E1000 emulation, we got up to 150,000 packets per second, which is a good improvement, but still slow. By implementing another technique called send combining that acts only on the sender side, and the idea is when you send a packet, typically you have an interrupt to notify you that the transmission is complete. So then instead of sending every subsequent packet immediately, which causes a VM exit and a huge penalty, you wait to do the transmission until you get the interrupt back. And then you can send the entire batch at once. And then you see by implementing these send combining techniques, the throughput becomes very high, about 300,000 packets per second. The black numbers are with the openvswitch interconnect between virtual machines. And by replacing the openvswitch with our valet switch, we got up to almost 1 million packets per second. This emulated E1000 is not Virt.io. Virt.io gets similar numbers. Virt.io has a slightly better performance for bulk TCP transfers because, especially if you use it with vHost, there is one less task handoff. And if we use the paravirtualized version of E1000, we basically get about the same type of performance as Virt.io, 1 million packets per second with the processes through UDP sockets. Yes? Virt.io with vHost is matching the red numbers that you see here. Without vHost, there is a... I don't remember the number exactly, but probably you lose 20-30%, but you lose a lot in latency. So on bulk TCP transfer, you see a lot of the difference. And the things that we did recently, just mentioning, is that now the valet switch can be connected direct. A part of the valet switch can be connected directly to a physical interface, still using the netmap API, so it's very fast, and can be connected to the host stack, which is faster in a way. But then, when you go to the host stack, you basically have to do the conversion into SK buffer, et cetera, et cetera. Well, anyways, I see that I'm short of time, so.
Mm-hmm. Are you thinking Veil is a replacement for that, or is it augment that? How would you position
the work that we have done recently is to connect the Vale forwarding plane with the OVS logic. So when Vale gets a batch of packets, it can call the OVS code to decide which port to apply, basically the computation of the destination. Exactly. So we've merged that. That would be the valley switch, yes. The last thing that I mentioned. Okay?
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.